Hello everybody, welcome back for another review. Today I'm diving into another TV show, one that should have been kept afloat for a lot longer, even though it didn't. Today we are going to be revisiting Theodore Tugboat. So put your fishing trousers on and let's get ready to dive in.
Looking back. The harbor and the ocean. Isn't it such a relaxing setting? Seeing what lies just beyond the edge of the shore is a fascinating sight. The ocean makes up the majority of the Earth, and yet we humans know only a fraction of what exists below. Yet, we've been able to master the water above, for the most part, because of boats. That wonderful flotation device that is able to transport all kinds of things from one landmass to another. Whether it be heavy artillery, general freight, human beings, or produce, boats and other marine vessels have been around a lot longer than many other transport devices. But have there been any memorable ships in history that people fondly remember? Well, there are, but it seems most people remember the shipwrecks. Why is it that we tend to remember ships with tragic histories? The USS Arizona from Pearl Harbor, the RMS Titanic, the Hunley, or the USS Cyclops? I mean, obviously we remember them for good intentions, I'm not denying that. But I think we should remember other boats that have left a different lasting impression, like Scuffy or Littletoot.
Ah yes, the fictional boats have left us some goodies too. Specifically, the class known as the Tugboat.
Yes, tugboats. The little gremlin boats that go floating around the harbor for what seems like no reason. When in fact, they play a very crucial role in their line of work, just like any other vessel would. But how would this be shown to children in a simple yet entertaining way that could also teach them valuable lessons? Well, very little, at least for the UK or US. See, the thing is, while boats have been around longer, locomotives always seem to be more captivating to young kids. And one set of books and a TV show only drove home that point. That's right, the Reverend W. Awdry's Railway series and Britt Allcroft's Thomas the Tank Engine and Friends TV show adaptation of said series had many kids already enthralled by the idea of sentient steam engines by 1984. You have to give them credit, they definitely made something of it. While that series was airing in the UK, another show, flat out called Tugs, was also released in 1989. Sadly, the show didn't make it past one season, due to studio bankruptcy. But it was not all in vain.
That's right, there's a special connection between what I'm reviewing and the background behind it. Although I must say, I think most of my viewers already know this.
The producers who were working on the Tugs show, David Mitten and Robert D. Cardona, were also producers to the Thomas and Friends show. When Tugs got canceled, Mitten remained with Thomas and Friends. Cardona, on the other hand, later on moved to Canada where he would meet with a man by the name of Andrew Cochran. It was Cochran who was also working on a production that involved sentient boats, after seeing tugboats in the harbor and being inspired to tell his young son stories about them. Beginning in 1993 and closing out in 2001, Theodore Tugboat's impact in North America was about as equal to that of the famous Blue Tank Engine. He was popular enough to warrant his own life-sized replica, which is still stationed in Canada, and is the official ambassador of the U.S. National Safe Boating Council and mascot to the U.S. Coast Guard. That's pretty significant. What's more interesting is that Cardona was able to revive something sort of like Tugs, even though they were nothing alike. That and the fact that Cochran didn't even have source material to base his episodes off of is even more impressive. I also think the team was lucky no one thought of the show as a complete and blatant knockoff to that of Thomas. Although I'm sure there were some that thought it might have been. And I could see why, since the original airing in the UK and Shining Time Station started off with Ringo Starr narrating the stories, and Theodore Tugboat featured Denny Doherty, another 1960s iconic singer from the Mamas and the Papas in live action.
That's really something, the fact that they share one colleague from two different shows. I mean, what were they thinking? They almost took everything verbatim. But, you know what, quite honestly, worked out in their favor. They were the ones who thought outside the box.
Overall plot and writing. The story is about an eager young tugboat by the name of Theodore, who arrives at the Big Harbor, his newly assigned post for future work. He's excited to make progress, make friends, and can be a little naive at times. There he spends his time getting to know his main colleagues, further exploring the area around him, meeting new faces from large to small, old to young, and all around learning important life lessons that anyone can relate to. Running the harbor is the harbor master, who then gives directions to the dispatcher. Stationed at the Great Ocean Tug and Salvage Company dock is Hank, a tug in similar structure to that of Theodore, young and bursting with energy. There's Emily, the only female tug who's soft-spoken but still has a large presence. There's Fodok, the fire tug, who's usually patrolling the areas for hazards. And then there's George, a thick-headed and boastful tug who sometimes gets a little too caught up in his greatness. For the 5 seasons and 130 episodes total, it is by far one of the most wholesome of wholesome shows to exist out there. It's a show that makes characters identifiable in their scenarios and personalities in a way some would feel maybe too hard to portray because they're boats. Not so. Although, it does seem a little more complex, being that 99% of the stories take place on water.
You'd be surprised about the kind of topics they cover in this show. The thing is, this show had a little more leeway, seeing that it didn't have anything to base its stories off of to begin with.
Of course, because the show wasn't based on any pre-existing literary work, Cochrane had full rein of how the show's universe worked, while simultaneously using ideas from shows like Shining Time Station as well, to some degree. Unlike Shining Time Station, though, which had a much larger live-action segment and larger cast, Theodore Tugboat consisted of just one cast member, and that was Denny Doherty. The format of each episode was also modified. So instead of telling a story while the viewer watched, the story was told to a viewer as if it were real life. Doherty would come in explaining something that might have happened that day or some objective he has to do, and then he has some kind of dilemma. After pondering for a bit, he then is able to think of a story very similar to his that happened to the Tugs. My gosh, does he have a remarkable memory. To remember 130 different stories? He must be very lonely. After all, his only friends, aside from the Tugs, are his mother, another colleague by the name of Rodney, and his pet fish. Makes you wonder, does he sing Monday, Monday when he comes into work every start of the week?
Monday, Monday, so good to me.
I mean, it kind of fits, right? If he is that lonely, that song kind of matches the whole scenario. But enough about that. Let's go on about the lessons that this show covers.
Joining in and listening to the Harbor Master stories brings up all kinds of important lessons like the following. Learning how to be unique. Doing things your own way. Not knowing how to express discomfort. New isn't always better. Paying attention. Learning to deal with others' attitudes. Lying. Wandering off with strangers. Not being the center of attention, going too far with the imagination, being stuck between an argument, having fun with friends, or having more isn't always better. All these activities are things kids should learn about as they grow up, so they can be better human beings to each other. There are some really hard-hitting stories to watch, too. Stories like True Blue Friends is great because it involves keeping secrets that are not so easy to keep. Bedford's Big Move is about feeling lonely or unwanted. Theodore and the Boat Bully is still a relevant story to this day because people in general are still bullied even now. Even the Great Harbor Cleanup Contest is a big deal because it's definitely important to be environmentally responsible with our waste. These kinds of stories are the ones that can focus on any character in the show, sometimes main characters and other times supporting characters.
That's not all, though. The show does develop its characters, too, in a number of ways.
Now, can I say the development of these characters go very far? To an extent, but it's not like the differences between Season 1 and Season 5's Tugs are largely nothing of what they were when they started. For the main cast, the direction the Tugs went in is taken case by case. Some make strides while others sort of remain the same. Hank, the other smallest tugboat on the fleet, is a lot like Theodore. His development is on a social level. Becoming friends with Theodore was fairly easy for him, but getting to know others was a challenge. He also finds ways of making himself more important than he initially comes off. While he was relegated to smaller volume jobs, by the final season, he's finally the head tugger of a big vessel job.
As Hank kept moving Kingston through the harbor, he was as careful as can be. He didn't want any scrapes this time.
Hank is a character many can relate to who are not totally sure of themselves and want to improve. Going to the opposite end of the spectrum, George is nothing like Hank. Aside from the dispatcher, George is usually the tug in charge. It's because of that title which makes George very bossy and close-minded. He does, however, get his comeuppance in some stories, whether it be that he thinks he saw a ghost or ends up making a weird noise. As viewers get closer to the end of the show, they will also see George meet someone that has a bigger reputation than him and goes through a few more situations that help him realize brute force isn't always the key to success.
Maybe we should ask Foduck if it's all clear up ahead,
Theodore called to George.
There's no time for that today, replied George, moving along. Hurry up!
George is probably one of the more harder characters to relate to because anyone who is thick-headed like him may not be open-minded enough to see the similarities.
You see, George's focus is more on his attitude and hubris, but at the same time, both of them kind of got that development later in the show by, like, season 5, so it's a little too late.
Foduck, the official safety tug, is one of the more special vessels of the fleet. For one, he's the only tug to be safety certified and carry around fire equipment. This makes him very important, but upon initial presentation, he's not actually sure about that. It's because of his special purpose he feels like an outcast until he gets his V-word. which is another way of saying a tug has graduated to becoming a fully-fledged ocean tug. Fodok also learns the value of new technology by respecting the past when he meets another vessel named Blue Nose. As time goes on, Fodok also learns the importance of his own job, not taking it overly serious, and having patience with others. These kinds of character arcs can be related to that of an older sibling, which is what Fodok feels like very much to Theodore.
Theodore? Said Fodok, floating over. All shipshape? Is your engine tired? Maybe your bilge water is backed up.
No, no, replied Theodore with a smile. Everything's just fine, Fodok. Thanks.
Emily, on the other hand, balances the older sibling trait while also taking on the role of a more caring side of the fleet. I wouldn't say she acts as a mother, because that's a totally different mindset. But what she does have is a much softer approach to tackling issues. Unlike Fodok, who's all about the rules, and George, who's all about bum-rushing things, the kind of development she goes through is more related to her reputation, whether it be regarding her skills or her image in general. Stories like when she makes a new friend with an unlikely vessel named Constance, who's not so empathetic. Or Carla, a sleek cabin cruiser who has a daring persona. She also discovers picking up a foreign object are best addressed by a professional. There's also plots about her being in denial, whether it be her ability to turn fast or sleep drifting.
What happened? What are you doing out here?
I was looking for you, replied Theodore. You were floating in your sleep again. Well, when Emily heard this, she felt really silly.
Now that we've gotten through those two, let's move on to the red baseball cap wearing newbie.
Ah yes, Mr. Theodore Roosevelt. I mean, Tugboat. How have you grown? As a newbie to the Great Ocean Tug and Salvage Company dock, this guy has been through quite a lot. Theodore's progression is a little harder to pinpoint. Since he is the central character majority of the time, his arc gets an even dose of different character traits that his other friends portray more abundantly. There are times where he learns his own needs are not as a priority as he thinks, such as when he tells a lie, accidentally jokes without considering the feelings of others, or when he feels showing how to do something has to be done the way he does it. Then there's the career development. Since Theodore wants to become an ocean tug, he also goes through several setups that bring him closer to his goal, even though by the end of the show, he never gets his V-word. Things like learning to pull ships and working the night shift are just starting points for him, only to venture out even further by taking literal journeys outside the harbor limits, and taking on more leadership-like roles to bring himself closer to the overall goal.
But Theodore saw, and he also saw it was time to do something.
Stop!
He called to George, and he raced as fast as he could between the big tug and Seabright. Theodore, shouted George, please get out of the way.
All in all, though, each of these puffers work to help and care for each other. There's at least one episode dedicated to one of the tugs in a big way, and it's a great way to all make them important. Fodok's special moment is when he graduates to a V-tug. George's big day is when he's in line to receive the Tug of the Year award. Theodore's is when all of his friends surprise him on his birthday. Emily's moment is when she leads the tugboat parade through the harbor. And Hank is for when all of his friends comfort him when he's feeling down. They are all really significant scenes that should make any viewer smile along with the characters. However, this doesn't mean the show doesn't have its issues with the stories. Oh yes, as wholesome as the plots are, sometimes they really don't add up when audiences come to know their characters. The biggest mistake this series has problems with is its continuity. It's not like they don't know their own stories, but for some reason certain stories are put in orders that make no sense. These errors happen immediately right off the bat in season 1 by starting their first episode on a random story and ending the season with the episode that introduces Theodore. It would be one thing if the writing had words that made the viewer feel like they were being told a past event, but instead, it's made to be like the audience has never heard of Theodore. There's also the episode where Theodore has his first pull, and it's played after he's given his fake V-tug word. There's even the final episode of season 3 where Pearl first meets Petra, the new pilot boat, yet both were featured in prior seasons together. There's also a story about Fodok discovering his love of moving in reverse. This is totally out of character since he's the established safety tug. How would he even find this acceptable? There's another silly thing about this show. Like Thomas and Friends, the show can't exactly figure out what is sentient and what isn't. Consistently. In an episode involving cleanup of the harbor, it is shown that humans exist in this universe. Yet, aside from the boats and some landmark buildings, some other items that are alive aren't always shown to be. Throughout the show, the tugboats will bring and lead out ships with different kinds of cargo. But the most abundant of them all are the ships that bring in large bulk containers. You know, those metal Jenga boxes, which are completely inanimate. But later on, there's an episode where a ship carrying other assorted cargo has a life of their own. So when does cargo have life and when does it not? Speaking of inanimate, there's another weird set of characters in this show that were never established before, and that's the Rhyming Rocks of Ecom Secom. They appear in the very last episode of the very last season. Why they were never introduced before and saved until now? Who knows, but they are really jarring to say the least. And what's with the tugs and their exhaust? It's stated in several episodes that they run on oil. Yet they output steam? Just another part of having to suspend your disbelief, I guess. Writing the stories to these episodes was a small group of people. Of this small group, mind you, majority of them were not even listed on IMDb, which is a shame. Heck, IMDb doesn't even know the total number of episodes, which is 130. Excuse me, not 110.
No!
These pages need updates. Come on, guys. Anyway, a little offshore at this point. The group of writers involved has an even smaller group of people that participated at certain degrees. Some wrote for a bunch of episodes, while others did very little. People like Lynn M. Turner, Silver Donald Cameron, Kathy McLellan, Vicky Grant, and Cheryl Wagner are the set of folks who worked here and there on the show. Some also had credits to shows like Under the Umbrella Tree and The Big Comfy Couch. Noice! As for the others, Bob Stutt, Jeff Rosen, and Andrew Cochran were the main three who worked on the episodes. Bob Stutt has had a career with puppets and has worked with the Henson Company. He also wrote for Pippi Longstocking. Jeff Rosen, second in line for having the most episodes written, would later write for Bo on the Go and Animal Mechanicals. Yeah, that's a tongue twister. His role was executive story editor. Then there's Andrew Cochran, the creator of the show. His credits go back to the Argon Quest, and received producer credit for Lifeline to Victory, and Pit Pony. Lastly, Robert D. Cardona directed most of the episodes to the show, having producer and director credits to shows like Emmerdale, The Flaxton Boys, and most notably Thomas and Friends to this day. It's probably safe to say Cardona is pleased with how much time he was able to put into this production, seeing that his original creation, Tugs from the UK, didn't go very far.
So while the show may suffer from inconsistent writing and bad continuity at times, that doesn't mean the show isn't worthwhile watching because the values behind it are good intentions and also it's just good learning for a young mind.
Actors and characters. As mentioned before, the actors in this series is as minimal as you get. There's only one live-action actor in this show, and that is Denny Doherty. And although he voices every character on the show, he does a decent job at giving most of them all distinct voices. But before we get into that, let's talk about Doherty's performance by himself. For the intro and outro, fans will be greeted by him doing something, whether it be something serious or more lighthearted. And it could be either during the day, during the night, stormy weather, snowy weather, or any other kind of weather. Either way, Doherty plays the harbor master well enough that he comes across like a guy who knows his job, as well as being a bit goofy. He's either forgetting his pencil.
Where's my pencil? I had it a minute ago. Now, where did I put my pencil?
Talking about his good buddy Rodney.
Do you remember my friend Rodney from the shipyard here in the Big Harbor?
That was my friend Rodney.
And on my birthday, my friend Rodney, well, he usually hides a cake somewhere here in my office.
Rodney! Could you please stop playing those bagpipes?
Oh, no. This must be my friend Rodney.
Playing the same tune on his tuba. Pulling an all-nighter, or, I don't know, just random things.
Look at this. Here's another great thing I got. It's a pencil. No. Oh, well, this is no good either.
Even his fish are good performers. More like they were probably able to capture the fish doing the right thing at the right time. I wonder if they had a camera rolling for hours just to get the right movement. Doherty himself, aside from belonging to the Mamas and the Papas, also played characters in Oh What a Night, The Real Howard Spitz, Pit Pony, and Prince Charming, all TV movies. Sadly, Doherty passed away in 2007 at 66 due to kidney disease, which was too soon for his age. Now for the main characters. Theodore, the franchise mascot, is an eager McBeaver tugboat with a solid red hat. Wanting to always do the right thing and make friends, Theodore is a tug who seeks to make things better than before he came in contact with it. But since he's still a new tug, there's a lot for him to learn when it comes to stepping up. His personality reflects that of someone still in their youth learning the ranks of certain job titles and responsibilities. As mentioned before in the writing portion of this video, Theodore does go through several growth stages, whether that be professionally or socially among his fellow floaty boats. The way Doherty voices Theodore could be labeled as very neutral. His voice is neither too masculine nor too feminine. It's the perfect pitch that should warm over any viewer.
A visit from Theodore was the most special of all.
Bedford, called Theodore. I just took Clara, the cargo ship, out to the ocean. Can you guess what she was loaded with? No, replied Bedford. Bicycles, shouted Theodore.
Thankfully for Theodore, he has a friend around his age he can springboard off of for help when he needs it. This leads us to Hank, the blue beanie-wearing quirky tug who's a bit naive and not as serious at times and tends to come off that way to others. This unfortunately puts him in scenarios where he has to prove himself, such as when he mistakes a mermaid figurehead as an actual mermaid, or when he ends up making too much noise during a job and is sent back to the dock. It's because of his sensitive demeanor that he also sometimes feels not as important. One time he misunderstands Theodore when he not only calls him, but others his best friend, forcing him to clam up. And while he may exhibit the flaws of being a little too gullible, Hank still wants to do the right thing and help out when he can. As for Doherty, his voice to Hank is similar to Theodore's, but kept in a much more energetic tone since that is what Hank embodies most.
What are you doing? Hank had stuck an old bell on his hat and big strips of seaweed under his nose for a mustache. Hooted Hank. Isn't it funny, Rebecca?
Now on to the V-tugs of the group. Oh yeah, now we're getting into the biggies.
Emily the Vigorous, our only teal fishing hat-wearing female tugboat, is a special gem. Of the crew, she's the only one accomplished enough to have taken the most trips outside the harbor. Now, while the other two are also V-tugs, she's the one always being mentioned of going to multiple places. She's also very proficient in her job and enjoys the practice of doing the job correctly the first time. Unfortunately, this is where she has a glaring character flaw. When she's not able to do something correctly, she begins to get very hot-headed. A funny example of that is when she's in denial over the fact that she sleep drifts. However, while her temper may be sharp, it never lasts long. Her friends are always there to reel her back in. Not to mention, as time goes by, she also forms her own circle of friends that are also boats. This creates an interesting dynamic, seeing that you don't always have to have friends that do the same thing you do. Doherty's voice acting for Emily is remarkably well done. It's not always easy for one gender to portray the opposite, but here he manages well, giving Emily a soft but assertive delivery.
Well, what's everyone waiting for? Let's finish docking this ship.
Well, even in the last light of twilight, Theodore and Hank knew who it was as soon as they saw that soft, floppy, familiar old hat.
Fodok the Vigilant is one-of-a-kind fire-red helmet-wearing safety tug for the harbor. Constantly on the lookout, this guy has everyone's protection in mind. 99% of the time. Fodok has an interesting progression in his character. He's the only tug to graduate to an ocean-going V-tug in the show, and mind you, his transition happens fairly early. Yet, audiences will see that as seasons go by, Fodok sort of becomes more emotionally void. That's not to say he doesn't show anything on his face, but over time he sounds more rigid than he was portrayed to begin with. Nevertheless, Fodok is a tugboat with good intentions, and sometimes he gets too caught up in the moment, whether it be work or something social-related. Doherty's performance for Fodok is a likable one. Even in his more sterner tone, Fodok usually has a good line to say. Definitely for this character, the vocals are baritone enough for a masculine boat such as him.
Excuse me, said Fodok, moving close to the dispatcher. But I believe we do have something to do this morning. My emergency signal flag class, replied Fodok very seriously.
All the tugs groaned.
Not this morning.
Then there's George the Valiant, the big backwards purple cap wearing tugger. George is the definition of a lot of common traits. He's the essential leader of the group when it comes to getting things done. He has lots of experience and is stronger than any other tug in the fleet. However, this also leads him to believe that he's not without flaws, which is totally incorrect. That thought process alone is an issue. George is just as flawed as his colleagues. It's his strength that gives him the feeling of invincibility. It's his experience that makes him feel like no one can tell him what to do because he knows best. It's these kinds of thoughts that tend to make George very stubborn and hard to work with. However, when his team relies on him, George is always there to help. There are also some moments where George is insecure of what he feels, but this is not shown in large volumes. The way George's voice comes out of Doherty is much more brash and cocky, an accurate fit for a smug tugger. And there's no mistaking that George is the epitome of more brawn over brains. Sometimes.
Can I try?
Asked Emily.
No, you can't, said George.
Why not?
Asked Emily.
Because you're a girl tug, said George. Girl tugs can't do tug of war.
All right, now that we've covered the main five, let's discuss the other ships that took part along with the tugs, but also really left a memorable impression or were just featured a lot.
Let's begin with the pilot boats, Pearl and Petra. At first, viewers may think these are actually twins, when in fact they are not. They share the same coloring, but their shapes are slightly dissimilar from each other. Again, one would think otherwise after hearing Doherty voice them. They pretty much sound exactly the same. At least from my experience, there's no writing that distinguishes the two from each other, aside from their looks. For the most part, their personalities are equal too. They both monitor the tugboats as they do their job, and they both guide the team as they work in case any extra dialogue is needed to be communicated. However, there are some episodes dedicated specifically to them. One is about them paying attention to the tugs on a personal level and not from a job point of view.
"I'm sorry I haven't moved the barge yet," said Theodore. "I was going to do that next." "Oh, that's okay, Theodore," said Petra. Then Pearl made an announcement. "Theodore, you've been very brave."
Next is Rebecca, the research vessel. Originally just set as a background boat, not even a character, mind you, ended up having her own stories much later in the show. She's a kind, knowledgeable boat who often fancies herself going on discoveries with other friends and looking for adventure, along the same lines as Theodore. But as experienced as she is, she too needs to be careful and can sometimes be a little too into her work. Doherty's voice acting for Rebecca is about the same as Emily.
"I bet bringing in big ships makes you cheerful," said Rebecca. "Being a tugboat must be lots of fun." "Being a tugboat is lots of fun," replied Theodore. Rebecca seemed so interested in him that right away he felt a little bit better.
Floating around the harbor is Philip and Fillmore, the fairy twins. They too are in several episodes, but do not really have their own character arcs. The only time an episode that puts focus on them is in the last season of the show, where Fillmore gets bored and decides he wants to be more than a fairy. It's something, but as the saying goes, too little too late. Most of the time, they just exchange lines with each other when others interact with them. It can be funny at times, it just depends on the situation. For voices, Doherty slips on this. In some episodes, he voices them with a Marvin the Martian tonal pitch. And in other episodes, he makes them sound more normal. Maybe Doherty forgot? I don't know, but the inconsistency feels sudden when the voices are different from what they usually are.
"Hi, Philip," he called. "Hi, Fillmore."
"I'm Philip,"
said Philip, the way he always did.
"And I'm Fillmore,"
said Fillmore, the way he always did. Theodore grinned. It was always kind of hard to tell those twins apart.
"We hear you're inspecting anchors today,"
called Philip.
"And we were wondering,"
Fillmore continued,
"if you could inspect our anchors, too."
"The fairy twins, too?"
groaned Emily.
"Oh, no. I'll never get to meet Gregor."
Helping bring in some nostalgia is Blue Nose, an old ship powered by nature, as in the wind. Unfortunately for this character, her usage declines as the show continued. Being reduced to a background character isn't usually good, but at least she spoke during 3 of the 5 seasons she appears in. Blue Nose's most notable contribution is when she shows how useful she can be. Sometimes old-fashioned can still be good. She's not what you call an old grandma, but she still can be counted on for her optimism and friendly personality. Doherty's voice for this, again, is on par with Emily and Rebecca. Nothing more, really. What makes her memorable is the kind of boat that she is and the lesson she teaches.
"Hello, Blue Nose," called Theodore. "You sure look beautiful with your sails full of wind."
"Why, thank you, Theodore," replied Blue Nose with a smile in her voice. "You really spread the sunshine around."
There's also Digby, the cable ship whose most notable attribute is getting stuck everywhere. This Newfoundland-accented ship is something to admire for a specific reason. No matter how many times he gets stuck, he continues to try and be better, as unsuccessful as he is. Not appearing until season 2, Digby would also be able to meet another cable ship and also make more acquaintances in the harbor aside from Theodore. He even gets the chance to experience the flip side of life where he finds himself helping others. Doherty's work on Digby is probably the most recognizable because the character is one of the few with a distinct voice. It's either because the Newfoundland accent is so different, or it just stands out a lot compared to all other Doherty character voices.
"Digby," shouted Sigrid. "It's you."
"Of course it's me," replied Digby. "Who else would I be?"
Originally, the model used for Digby was another ship called Camel, who was dead in a couple of episodes. However, this brings in a whole different topic. Do characters also die in the show? I mean, surely they go somewhere when no longer useful, but why would the show plainly put this out on display? It's a bit dark considering this was early on in the show. Either way, I'm sure the similarities can be seen in both characters. On to other living characters, Constance the Coast Guard ship is another vessel who takes her job very seriously. And she should. Being a part of the Coast Guard is not an organization revolving around comedy. Just like Fodok, she is there to support when it comes to emergencies and is very well equipped for various jobs. The thing is with her, she was in need of lightening up, which is part of her development in the show. Over time, she too begins to have a more steady working relationship with the tugs. She even learns how to have fun along with working. Doherty's voice work for Constance is fine. Since there's a bit of a transformation regarding her personality, she starts off more stern, and then later on becomes softer, especially when she spends more time with the Tugs.
Do you see those stars there that look like a big soup spoon?
Uh-huh, replied Hank.
They call those the Big Dipper,
Constance continued.
If you ever get lost out here, just follow the spoon home.
Floating around the other Tugs is also Northumberland, the sleepy submarine. Since his job occurs during the opposite time of the day, Northumberland isn't usually so lively during his time on screen. However, when he is around, he's pretty cool seeing him interact with the stories told. Sometimes when Northumberland speaks, he dozes off mid-sentence. Whenever Northumberland is involved, most of the time there's a couple shots of him underwater, and going under the surface is always cool to see. The way Doherty uses his voice for this character is as one would guess, much more slothish. Since the submarine works during the night, he's shown as very sleepy during the day. So really, all Doherty had to do was just yawn while he read the lines. I can only imagine how legit tiring it might have gotten yawning for every bit of dialogue. Could you imagine him falling asleep while recording lines in the studio? As for the character, he doesn't receive a lot of development, and that's okay since he's usually too tired for anything anyway.
Northumberland, have you seen Theodore?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I saw him. Oh, I saw him taking that pilot around the harbor.
And then he fell fast asleep, right there where he floated.
Coming last but not least is Sigrid, the friendly helicopter hat supply ship. While this friendly ship is only introduced late in the show, she turns out to be a very meaningful addition. She may be one of the few supply ships in the harbor, but she is an important one at that. And even for the smaller number of episodes that she has, she does have a couple character arcs that are interesting to watch. She not only develops a close friendship with Emily, but also delves into what it could be like to be a tugboat. Since she's close in design, Doherty's vocals for Sigrid aren't very different from that of the other female ships. Because really, at this point, how many ways could you vary his voice before he started sounding silly? Either way, the characterization of Sigrid is an enjoyable one.
If I had bumpers, I could be a tugboat too, said Sigrid.
Well, said Theodore slowly, I never thought it was my bumpers that made me a tugboat.
Sure it is, called Sigrid, hurrying off. I need bumpers.
Okay, now that we've covered that, let's look at the big ships that come into the show. Most of them only appear once or twice, but also are recognizable because of how they look.
The first of this next list to show up is R-Boat. Get it? Because R stands for row. Ha ha ha. Okay, moving on. R-Boat only appears for two episodes. One in season one, and the other in season three. Really, all that he is a rowboat who's almost unsatisfiable, making him probably one of the least likable characters on the show. Yet for those who love the show, definitely will know who R-Boat is. Mainly because the way Doherty voices him.
With a crybaby type of voice.
Complaining about everything. Yeah, he's not the most upbeat or pleasant of characters. Although his second and last episode, at least, completes his arc. Not sure why it took so long for the writers to do it, though. What a windbag.
My new dog shouldn't be too sunny, or my wood will crack. Or too rainy, or I'll rot. And it shouldn't be too in-betweeny, or I'll... This harbor has lots of good dogs, said Theodore.
Swiftly coming in next is Carla the Cool Cabin Cruiser. She has all of about five episodes involving her, but she's the kind of character that is all about being popular and being the center of attention. This also means she doesn't tend to notice the importance of when it's time to play versus when not to. At one point, she takes the new bumpers from the Tugs just to get them to play with her, causing lots of confusion and false accusations. It's probably safe to say Carla isn't the most popular character, but she's also recognizable because of the way she is. Doherty makes Carla sound very similar to that of Hank, but with a higher-pitched voice. Not much else to say there.
Let's go look at the really deep place where the biggest ships come in.
Okay, said Emily. But we'll have to remember that getting too close to the path where the big ships come in can be very dangerous.
Oh, I know, said Carla. But it'll be exciting.
Going on to another peppy young boat is Dorothy, the yellow rowboat. Seeming to take the design straight from our boat, Dorothy is the exact opposite of the depressed red boat when it comes to personality. Dorothy is always excited about hearing stories and has hopes to learn as much as possible about the big harbor. Rarely is she ever sad, and she even gets the chance to hang out with all the other female characters later on in the show. Doherty's voice for her is also very upbeat and energetic, since Dorothy in general is a very excitable little boat.
Theodore! Theodore! How was your trip? What did you see along the coast?
She couldn't wait to find out.
Living with Dorothy is Truro, the unibrow fishing trawler. Truro is the older ship with the most experience, which also keeps an eye on Dorothy and her bubbly interests. While he doesn't do a whole lot, he does have one episode where it's about him and his feelings and being noticed. The voice for him isn't very distinguished, but it's done well enough. Now, as for Truro, he wouldn't be introduced until season 4. But his model was used for a different ship in season 2, known as Gregor, a Russian ship visiting the harbor. And putting them next to each other shows there really isn't a big difference.
Hello, Theodore called. I'm Theodore Tugboat. Are you Kaylee?
Oh, no, laughed the trawler. My name is Truro.
But where's Kaylee?
Asked Theodore, looking around. Oh, there's no Kaylee here, answered Truro. That's just what they call it.
How do you do? Replied Gregor. I'm very pleased to meet you too.
Then there's Nautilus, the only Navy ship to be depicted in the show. He doesn't have a lot to say, but he does come across very important since, well, he's the only naval ship, as I said before. He's probably the only ship seen as a role model to that of George the Valiant. In fact, it's because of Nautilus George ends up going off the deep end with being all official. Nautilus did also monitor the work as the tugs helped remove a supertanker from a tight spot.
I've always wanted to know what Navy ships do, said George.
Well, replied Nautilus, I protect the oceans.
Protect the oceans, repeated George. Oh, I'd like to do that.
Going back to submarines, Pugwash is the only other submarine vessel to appear on the show. The only one to be a mini-sub, too. She is very enthusiastic and sees Northumberland as the way George sees Nautilus. The thing is, Northumberland finds Pugwash to be very obnoxious. But that's kind of how all I'm your biggest fans are, right? And of course, because she's a sub, we'll also get to go underwater. It's funnier when Northumberland tries to avoid her at all costs. It's like she's the plague or something. Jeez, she's not that bad.
I bet Northumberland will be really excited to see you again, smiled Hank. Where is Northumberland?
Said Pugwash.
I can't wait to see him. He should be floating by here any moment, smiled Theodore.
Bedeck is the buoy boat of the harbor, picking up and hauling the buoys out of the water for inspection and maintenance. While he doesn't have many episodes that directly involve him, the couple that do are some very interesting ones at that. One time, Theodore misinterprets Bedeck's job and thinks the buoys prefer Bedeck over him. What's more surprising is just seeing how big the buoys are when Bedeck lifts them out of the water. They're like icebergs. There's more underneath the water than what you can see.
Theodore told Bedeck all about the adventure he was planning with Bedford.
Well, that sounds like a wonderful idea, said Bedeck.
The two set off right then and there. Theodore smiled. He couldn't wait to see Bedford's face when he told him the surprise.
Fundy, the small fishing boat, is more of an anomaly than a character, showing up from time to time from season 3 onward. This little guy doesn't provide much but expressions, and they don't usually add much context to the plot at hand. It's weird thinking about it as to really what was the point of including him. But whatever, it's another character Doherty changes his voice for making him sound deep, vocally and verbally.
I live in the big harbor, smiled Theodore. But I'm going out on the ocean. I'll probably be going all the way across soon.
The ocean wasn't filled in a day, said Fundy in his deep voice.
And then he was silent again.
This boat says strange things.
Making a much more memorable introduction was Seamus, the Irish sea trawler. Only having one episode to himself, he's the only ship to be fully covered in ice, and yet Hank and Theodore have no idea what to do with him. Doherty is able to pull off a convincing, albeit very light Irish accent, making Seamus all the more interesting to hear.
Top of the morning to you, tugboats, said the trawler. You sure are funny.
Theodore and Hank, they could only stare at the ship in amazement.
Allow me to introduce myself, said the ship. My name is Seamus, and I'm a sea trawler.
Unfortunately, Seamus would only stick around for the season he was introduced and would later be repurposed as another intriguing character in season 5 called Millie. This female fishing trawler has the misfortune of having poor eyesight. But this all gets addressed for the episode she's introduced, with the most obvious of illogical answers. Yeah, kind of like another character of a different fandom. I guess it makes about as much sense as the Tugs wearing big human hats. Anyway, it's really too bad both characters were not kept on the roster for very long in the show.
Can't you see us?
Millie tried and tried to make out their shapes in the dark.
Of course I can see you,
she said, her voice getting smaller.
It's just that you're kind of fuzzy.
The final tugboat to be seen in this show is Oliver the Vast. And while he only appears for one episode, he too plays an important role in growing. Oliver is a big blue-hatted bully boat. Yes, and it's because of Oliver a children's show should cover that kind of material. I'm serious. Bullying still happens today. He's probably one of the few who Theodore was not able to win over with his personality. Instead, Oliver continues to knock him around. Not cool. Not to mention he visually matches George very closely. How he got his V-word, one will never know. Doherty's performance is notable too, making Oliver sound very nasally and annoying. You may also notice Oliver looks familiar, and that's because Oliver's model was used as Sigrid the supply ship in later seasons. Ah yes, now we see the resemblance. That's one change I'm sure everyone's grateful for.
Leave my friend alone,
shouted George. Oliver kept on staring straight at Theodore, as if George wasn't even there.
I guess a little tug like you needs other tugs to fight for him.
Halliburton is a houseboat located in one of the more empty areas of the harbor. Too bad the area he's in is not tended to as much because Theodore wasn't sure what he was at some point. I guess Halliburton hasn't interacted much with others either since he seems pretty skittish too. It would have been nice to see more of his character, but no, just one episode to him. Oh well. Doherty just makes him sound very soft-spoken.
Theodore, he announced, this is Halliburton. Halliburton, houseboat. He's very friendly, continued Fodok, and he doesn't think he's haunted. Hello, Theodore.
There's also Kulu, the Native American canoe. This character also has one episode to them, where it's about them telling mysterious stories and Fodok has a hard time believing since he's Mr. Technical. More importantly, how did one single canoe find its way to the big harbor? There's nobody even manning it. So does Kulu just wait in his cove until the tugs decide to visit? Sounds not only boring, but lonely.
This is a story about the Northern Lights, said Kulu. Ooh, said Hank, the Northern Lights. Long, long ago, continued Kulu, there was a great canoe built from the bark of a single tree.
And then there's Snorri, the Viking ship. What's there to say about this character other than I guess he's the only ship to visit the harbor who's a living relic, but it is a good story because it's about understanding one another's cultures. Although I'm not sure Vikings back then would agree on how they're depicted here. Snorri does have dialogue, but this was the only episode he was featured in, so he's not around for too long. Just like the Vikings.
I'm visiting harbors everywhere to tell stories about what it was like for us Viking ships to explore the ocean 1,000 years ago, explained Snorri.
Now that we've covered that, let's go over the big ships, the ones that carry the huge cargo. These most of the time don't show up as frequently, but are always around in the background no matter what story it is.
Of the ships to visit the Big Harbor, the biggest and grandest is Queen Stephanie, a ship of royalty that visits the Big Harbor not often enough, but almost once a season. It's her presence that brightens everyone's mood, mostly because it's an honor to have such an important vessel visiting such a place. She also has the fondest opinion of Theodore and helps him see situations in ways he wouldn't usually think of.
I'm very glad to see you. I missed you today. When Theodore heard this, he felt sad. I'm sorry, I couldn't help bring you in.
Then there's the complete opposite of important, and that's Scally, the ship who tends to overcollect souvenirs. Now, there's nothing wrong with holding on to things, but there should be some value or use for them. And that's Scally's issue, because everything he has is rather, well, useless. He has good intentions and is very generous with his things, allowing the tugs to play with his stuff. But his generosity doesn't provide much in added value. He seems to be better suited as a carnival ship, not to mention the things the tugs borrow from Scally as some of the most outlandish things. And when comparing them to scale on everything else, they're ginormous! While Scally only appears in one episode of Season 3, it is definitely one viewers will remember.
Let's go show everyone, said Theodore. Thanks for the neat stuff, Hank called to Scally.
Oh, you're welcome, fellas, said Scally. You both got real treasures there.
Going on to now some bigger vessels is Caraquette, a bulk container ship. She's one of the few who come to the Big Harbor with some serious cargo. I don't know what the Big Harbor needs with Caraquette's cargo, but they must be building something nuclear.
I'm George, and I'm here to take you to the harbor.
And I'm Theodore. I'm helping. Please, keep nice and steady when you move me, said Caraquette. My cargo can roll off my deck really easily.
Now, while Caraquette is certainly not the first container ship to be featured in the show, she is far more memorable than the other ships she was remodeled from. The ships that Caraquette was remodeled from, and was later remodeled to, were the characters Julia, Gloria Cornwallis, Jennifer, Henry, Catherine, and Clementine. And of course, putting them all together at the same screen, one can see the similarities. On to bigger fish, the supertankers. The number of tankers to appear is about the same as the list of bulk container ships. The most memorable of the set is Cancel Colossus, also known as the King of the Supertankers. Although I find that hard to compare, seeing that he was not made to look any bigger than the others. If he was as big as Queen Stephanie, then I would have no choice but to agree. Either way, while Canso is a supertanker, he loves having a clean harbor, and he also gets into his own pickle with pollution. What makes him most recognizable is his voice, which Doherty makes him sound like a mix of Kermit the Frog of the Muppets and Marvin the Martian from Looney Tunes.
"This is the cleanest harbor I've ever seen,"
said Canso suddenly. The Tugs were all a bit surprised, because Canso had a kind of a squeaky voice for a king.
The other tankers that look fairly similar in design are Chester, Claire, and Kokomo. There's also Cumberland and Colchester, who resemble more of each other, but still share some traits. There's also another ship by the name of Dartmouth, who looks like a supertanker, but his job is different. He lays cable. And what makes that more significant is that he's only around for two episodes, and yet it's far more engaging. That's because he develops a friendship with Digby, the local harbor cable ship. After all, Digby's sort of a welcomed outsider to the rest of the crew. It's Dartmouth who makes one of the most lasting impressions on Digby.
"Someone has to look after my cables."
"Well, that's only natural," said Digby. "I certainly hope he can find someone good."
"Would you like to be in charge of my cables when I'm gone?" asked Dartmouth.
"Would I?"
Emma Sophia is a ship that comes to the harbor during season 5 and helps Theodore find a missing item or experience Emily's sleep drifting. She's one of the few ships that has one of more uniquely shaped faces.
"And there, I'm in. Good work, you two."
With Emma Sophia safely docked, Theodore was all ready to try his new siren again.
"Let's go, Emily,"
he urged.
However, the catalog of characters wouldn't be complete without a jittery ship, and that's Seabright, a cargo ship who has a fear of crossing under bridges. More specifically, Benjamin Bridge, someone we'll get to shortly. Doherty makes Seabright very jumpy, and that makes it interesting, seeing that mostly all the characters in the harbor are calm, cool, and collected.
"What's your name?"
Seabright, replied the ship, coming to a stop.
Are you lost?"
Theodore went on.
"I'm looking for the crane dock. The crane dock?"
replied Seabright uncertainly.
There's also the Rule Breaker, known as Cabot, a cargo ship who cares little for his surroundings or others' feelings, similar to a barge we'll also get to. Cabot seems okay at first, but he quickly reveals his colors to Theodore. This is important for viewers to learn about because there will always be someone you may come across who doesn't care for the way things should be done, and will do it their way that may be unsafe.
"But I still can't tow you into the harbor until I'm sure you're safe."
"You don't have to tow me in," interrupted Cabot, "because I'm going in by myself."
In season 2, however, Cabot was originally another cargo ship called Frida. The notable thing that she does, though, is being Theodore's first ship to bring into the harbor on his own. Coming down to the last few, we move on to another ship who has the honor of being the first to be towed in by Hank. That ship is Kingston, another vessel with a low confidence level, but only because it's Hank's first time taking charge.
"Hank will be your tug in charge,"
Theodore announced to the ship.
"Me?"
Hank said, surprised.
"I'd rather have you bring me in, Theodore,"
the ship said nervously.
"Hank will do a very good job," smiled Theodore.
Kingston was also remodeled after another character earlier in season 5 named Igloo, who had no dialogue. But he appeared more than Kingston. How does that make any sense? Either keep Igloo in Igloo, or it should have been Kingston all along. But you know who's really pulling everyone's legs? It's SS Malarkey, a cargo ship who only shows up for one episode in season 5, but has a very strong influence. In a way, Malarkey is a bullcrap artist, but one could take what Malarkey symbolizes in various ways. You can categorize him as some character who's just trying to be sneaky, or, in a more sinister way, he could be the representation of stranger danger. The reason for this is how he tries to coax Hank into meeting him at the private place only he and him would know about. I mean, that's fairly sensitive material, and yet the show handles it in a way that isn't dark, but enough to get the point across to the viewer. As the old saying goes, if things don't feel right, they probably aren't.
"Tomorrow, after work, let's meet here behind Willie's Island. Then, head out to Sandy Beach to practice."
"Oh, that sounds great," said Hank,
excited about going on a real adventure with Malarkey.
"I can hardly wait to tell Theodore."
But then Malarkey frowned.
While this character's episode is more memorable, prior to this, Malarkey's model spent its time as Inverness, and before that as Catherine, both of which were featured in way more episodes but did not have much to add to the plot. Last of the ship group is one more because of how dim this character is. Remember we touched on Camel, the dead ship who would later be recast as Digby? Well, how about a ship that not only died, but also rotting away at the bottom of the sea? That's right, the show has one episode in season 5 where Hank finds a sunken ship. Makes you wonder, how long ago did that guy sink beneath the waves? Yeesh. and yet everyone acts so casual about it.
Okay, so that covers all the ships and other self-moving vessels. Let's cover now the relatively static characters, but also the buildings and other things after that that don't move at all. Yeah, I know, for 5 seasons, there's a lot of characters to this show.
First, let's look at the barges. Thankfully, there's not a lot of them, and most of them get a chance to be featured, at least once per season. Of the group, there was only one female barge, that being Bona Vista. She unfortunately has the least screen time, but her moments are fun, like when Carla the cabin cruiser hides her from Emily, or when she helps Hank find a mermaid figurehead in the ocean. Next is Bobby and Barrington Barge. The two of them were the top to be featured during the first 2 seasons. Both contributed in their own way and in various episodes. However, they seem to be the least interesting. Also, both sound relatively the same, so that makes them even less notable. As opposed to the next duo, who are a tad more entertaining to watch. Bayswater and Brunswick Barge are the two who are a little more lively. Bayswater sometimes has something snarky to say, while Brunswick is like an adrenaline junkie, seeking events that might rattle his hull, I guess. However, there's an episode in the final season where Theodore has to figure out how to get them to stop bickering with each other. It's a unique scenario because it partially focuses on them as well as Theodore.
How come I have to be on this side again? Brunswick asked.
Because you got to carry more pipes, that's why, said Bayswater.
Did not.
Did too.
Did not.
Did too.
But they have nothing on the next two. Feeding into more of an Oscar the Grouch persona from Sesame Street, Doherty voices Guysborough the Garbage Barge. Always frowning, scowling, and growling, Guysborough is the quintessential grumpy frump. But that's part of what makes him so funny. Guysborough's humor is negative, which is hard to make work sometimes for viewers, but it does here.
Now you stay right there while we bring in Canso Colossus, said Theodore.
I'm a garbage barge, griped Guysborough. Can't move by myself anyway. Not that I want to. Nowhere worth going in the first place.
Guysborough is very grumpy today.
Lastly, there's Shelburne, the biggest barge of the group. He's a massive guy with a huge crane arm as well. Unlike his fellow counterparts, Shelburne's purpose is for far greater operations that involve deep depths and bigger objects. And while he's competent, he's a bit sluggish in nature. And Doherty matches that well with a slow, deep, friendly voice.
Hey, my hat! Said George.
Oops. Sorry, George, said Shelburne.
George could tell that everything was going all wrong.
Moving on to buoys, there's only a few to be seen during this show's run, two of which viewers won't even realize were there to begin with. Those two were Bingham and Blankston Buoy. Both look very similar, if not exactly the same. Then there's the Broken Bell Buoy, which is colored green. Viewers will never get a name, but what is that? It looks so doofy with those googly eyes. I would have liked to know what his story was. What, did some ship legit ram into that buoy? Who would be so cruel? The point of a buoy isn't to play ping pong, you know. The next couple are really the only two to be given actual dialogue. The buoy furthest away from the harbor is Blanford, and he's social enough. I mean, being all by yourself out on the ocean, you'd want to talk to someone, right?
Well, if it isn't Theodore Tugboat, called Blanford. And what brings you out here?
I'm the new tug in charge of bell buoys, said Theodore. From now on, I'll be checking you every day.
Well, isn't that just the catfish's whiskers?
But of all to be shown, Bedford is the buoy of the harbor, because he practically is. Bedford is a buoy who loves seeing everyone and everyone seeing him, although at certain points he has interactions with Theodore only true friends would go through. Misunderstandings, funny moments, and regular discussions. Bedford is also one of the characters who gets an episode that is one of the most emotional.
Rebecca and I always find things underwater, continued Theodore. Northumberland submarine comes too. We found an old ship's bell once. Finding a bell would be nice, said the bell buoy.
Sort of following the same design as the buoys are the structures that come next. But it's a very short list, of which we will then move to completely static characters. Two characters that are technically stationary but can move are the two oil rigs of the show. The first one being Tex, a one-time only for season one, with a big Sam Elliott bushy mustache. For him, Doherty gives him a thick southern accent to go along with them, and it's done pretty well. As for him as a character, he's okay, but not the most likable characters. But not the worst.
There's a big storm coming. Do you need any help with your anchors?
Aw, you again, said Tex, cutting off George. Why don't you just run along now? I don't need your help. I got more important things to do than chatter with every little tub who just floats on by.
But after him, viewers become acquainted with the overly loud Owen, originally only used as a backdrop character, Owen was rather subdued. It was there Owen took off as a rather comical character, sometimes not realizing how loud he really is.
George smiled. Everything was nice and quiet.
Hello there, tugboats!
Someone roared. It was Owen, the giant oil rig.
Sure is good to see ya!
Moving to full-on structures now, the only character that's closer to the road is Benjamin Bridge. He doesn't usually have a lot to say, but when he does, his height has to do something with it, whether it be seeing things from afar or talking to people down below. And it's because of how tall he is that he's practically in every episode.
Who did you see? Asked Theodore.
Someone smaller than me and made from a tree,
said Benjamin mysteriously. Benjamin always loves telling riddles about all the things he can see from way up there.
The same could be said for Lily Lighthouse. She's always seen throughout the show. That's quite a long time sitting there. But at least she's familiar to the eye.
Hank, said Lily, I can't stop blowing my foghorn. It's foggy out. I have to warn ships and boats away from the sharp, dangerous rocks on Willy's Island.
Unlike Lunenburg the Lighthouse, who only appears a few times and only speaks once. She's very forgettable, considering that Lily seems to be the only one until she's displayed. But it's nothing much. The same could be said for Chimey, the clock tower of the Big Harbor. While not always shown in the background, he is there, but again, only has one episode where he speaks, and it's only at the very beginning. What's the point, writers? You might as well just assign these frivolous lines to some character we know.
Early one morning, the tugs were sound asleep at the Great Ocean Tug and Salvage Company dock when the town clock began to toll.
Time to wake up, tugboats, it was chiming.
This also proves not every character should be given something to say, either. Shediac the Supply Shed was originally quiet throughout the show until season 4. It's at that point he decides to talk, and just like how he's depicted, he's really not that exciting. He's just a building. A static, mundane, boring building. And he practically put Theodore to sleep, thanks to Doherty's monotone voice acting. Nice.
What shall we do today?
He asked finally.
Oh, very busy day today, replied Shediac. Very busy indeed. First we sit here for a while, nice and still. And then we sit some more.
One of the more interesting characters is Clayton the Harbor Crane. While he's very limited where he goes, Clayton is a jolly fellow who is happy to meet new people. The way he looks and sounds may remind viewers of an older man of sorts, but still a happy one. He's one of the few characters in the harbor that actually shows how cargo is loaded and unloaded on the docks.
Hello down there, the crane called back. I'm Clayton the Harbor Crane, and I lift the containers off the ships you move. Theodore smiled.
Then there's the good old dispatcher, a rotating building who flares his mustache at all sorts of angles depending on his mood. And of course, the way Doherty voices him ranges too, from very sharp to kind and understanding. Even he as a stationary character grows with the tugboats, which is a nice thing to see.
I'm very proud of you, Theodore, said the dispatcher in a gentle voice.
You are?
Said Theodore, surprised.
But I didn't do anything.
I'm glad you didn't try and deal with this bully by yourself, the dispatcher went on.
Before we end, though, there's two more characters that need to be mentioned, and that's the two sentient docks, one being Donald Duck, I'm guessing a play on Disney's Donald Duck, and Jasper Dock. Both have a number of episodes where they speak, however, they both only know one thing. Donald knows the phrase, in a very silly tone, and Jasper only knows, nope, in a very short tone. Both end up sharing some funny lines with other characters.
Now why isn't he going to his dock? Said the dispatcher. Do you think there's something the matter?
Said Donald. Of course,
is all Donald ever says.
You are not a dock?
Frowned Digby, beginning to lose his patience.
And that you are not completely covered in junk?
Nope,
said Jasper.
What a disagreeable dock,
muttered Digby, steaming off.
I can only imagine what the garbage barge is like.
Wow, that was a lot of characters. But it shows you how much you can utilize different characters in different ways in different scenarios. But now, enough of that. Let's move on to the visual aspects and what made the show so great.
Action and cinematography. Let me clarify. When I say action, I don't mean like explosive action. This wasn't that kind of show. What was meant was the kind of actions that happened during the show. For those who are unfamiliar with the nautical life, one could get a basic understanding as to what goes on in the harbor on a regular day. There's tugging, of course. Like that even needed to be said. There's spooky stories involving sea creatures, ghost ships, a haunted houseboat. There's fun events like the tugboat parade, cleanup contests, underwater searches, and ocean rescues. Even more impressive is that the film crew used actual pyrotechnics on their sets too for a couple episodes. When you're literally playing with fire with the models you need in order to make your show, that's living life on the edge. Thankfully, they didn't damage any of them, especially with Fodok the safety tug on board. The practical effects were utilized well too for the most part. The only set with live actors is where the harbor master works. As shown before, he spends a lot of time in his office. However, every now and then, he actually steps outside, which makes the world in this show feel that much more real. Aside from this, though, the other models used looked realistic. More specifically, for the various marine adventures the tugs have with each other. For example, the tugs befriend a whale they end up naming Walter, and he's a cute googly-eyed animal. During different kinds of weather, the harbor changes to reflect these types of settings, such as stormy weather, or frosty cold weather with tons of ice cubes floating around. And while I'm sure most can imagine these ice blocks are basically styrofoam, they do look like glacial ice. The icebergs themselves also seem rather intimidating when putting the boat's size into perspective relative to human scale. The same could also be said for all the clothing characters wear, from the tugboats themselves wearing their iconic hats, the dispatcher wearing a scarf and earmuffs, to other vessels having articles of clothing too. And a foam mustache. Or a giant lighthouse-sized scarf. Those are some big pieces of clothing. Now, it would be one thing if humans were never depicted in the show, but they were. Which also makes it weird how the tugboats are mentioned as they're the ones buttoning on to their ships. Really, is it them doing it? They don't have hands, but yet the only humans ever depicted was in one episode. The tugboats and other models, though, went through some nice changes over the show. The difference in tugs can be seen from everything after season 1. Initially, the tugs seem a little smaller and not as touched up. This can be seen in close-ups. The faces have this weird line or wire that runs from their nose to the bottom of their face. It's rather distracting. However, after that, it is removed, so it looks better. On top of that, the first season tug faces have mouths that look like they're made of flattened Twizzlers or some kind of clay. Sort of how Gumby had his mouth molded in his early seasons as well. For the rest of the show, their faces have specifically molded expressions, which look a lot better. Some other differences were, Fodok's helmet sits lower in the first season than in later seasons. Also, Rebecca the research vessel had some modifications like having eyebrows midway through season 2. Fred Allen, who also worked on the show Blizzard Island, was credited as Master Props Builder. The surrounding settings are shot competently, thanks to Tom Anthes as production designer and Peter Sutherland, who handled the camera. Whether it be during the day, sunset, or at late hours of the night, the camera easily gives its viewers just how different being on the ocean feels. The underwater scenes are probably the most fun, since much of the show is spent above the surface. Without Northumberland or Pugwash, we wouldn't have a reason to see something like this. More interesting is that the harbor setting is supposed to be an exact replica to that of Halifax Harbor. Not bad. Although I always thought it was depicting New York Harbor. And of this set, there are a bunch of iconic locations like the Great Ocean Tug and Salvage Company Dock, the Junk Dock, the Oil Refinery, Lily's Island, Cadley's Cove, the Repair Dock, the Pictou Peaks, and the beach. One of the more captivating-looking aspects is when Theodore is permitted to venture outside the big harbor borders. And as the show continues, there's an angle shown that displays the harbor from afar with Benjamin Bridge in the background. It really gives a sense to the viewer that Theodore really is further out in the ocean. That's cool. Only occasionally are there shots where the end of the set can be seen, and it's a little glaring to say the least. Tom Anthes would also be credited as production designer for Blizzard Island and the Argon Quest, and set designer for a show called The Halifax Comedy Fest, which Peter Sutherland also served as camera operator. The other person to give credit to is Bill Mather, as sound designer and post-audio engineer. Seeing that he was the one of the few people involved with the sound department on the show, you gotta admit, hearing all the horns blasting in the harbor was pretty awesome. Here are some clips.
"We're not," tooted one of the boats, whose name was Philip. "Lost." "Whew," said the ship. "That's a rotten day."
"Tactical maneuvers," he shouted. "Hide, hide, hide."
Mather would also serve as the sound editor to Drop Dead Gorgeous, one episode of Shining Time Station, believe it or not, as sound engineer, sound effects editor for Pit Pony, and more recently as a supervising sound editor for The Rendezvous.
I don't understand why the writers wrote it that way. In order to toot, they have to use their whistles, but really it's a horn? I don't get it. Anyway, let's move on to the audio part of the show.
Soundtrack and film score. For music, the TV score was composed by Graham Shaw. Originally a part of a group called Graham Shaw and the Sincere Serenaders, he would later find success in creating jingles for various other things. However, many people of the show recognize him as a big influencer as to why people remember the show as well as they do. The tools Shaw uses range from his signature instruments like the piano, a pan flute, not sure if it's synthesized or not, and bass synthesizers, which sort of sounds like boat horns. Whether it be more serious scenarios or softer ones, Shaw is able to bring out the right emotion in his music. One thing he does keep consistent is the overall feel to it. Whenever the music is playing in the background, but doesn't belong to the character, the sound is very ethereal and it matches the ocean-based show very well. Sadly, unlike the show, which is very similar in nature to Thomas and Friends, Shaw uses the show's main title as the theme for Theodore and his friends, which is a good way to summarize the crew. However, it would have been cool to see what Shaw could have composed per character. Instead, only a few character motifs are sprinkled throughout the show, and the rest are little jingles for random scenes which only further highlight Shaw's knack of conjuring such tunes. Here are some of those tunes.
So I don't need some little tug and tow truck's help in this little old harbor now. Well, George felt terrible. And they were dancing a pirate dance and singing yo, yo, yo. That's yo, ho, ho, said George. And Blue Nose sailed past. Isn't she beautiful? A young whale. Oh, the whale was very happy to be free again. I love parades, shouted Hank. He sailed in and out of the others as if he was already parading. Emily made her most determined face and set off, leading the parade with the other tugs tooting happily behind her. Was a spunky little cabin cruiser. She didn't work, and she was always on holiday, going wherever she liked, whenever she liked. And when she got there, she could do whatever she liked. Digby, said Theodore, you're not...
Stuck, said Digby.
I know, Theodore. I can't hardly get over it myself.
Then why did you call me? Asked Theodore.
Howdy doody there, George,
hollered Owen, the giant oil rig.
What brings you to these parts?
Shh, Owen, whispered George.
Since the show's end, Shaw has continued working and making music for various other brands like News World CBC, Labatt True Blue, and even Budweiser. He also released a solo album in September of 2008 called Raw Shaw, featuring original songs. All in all, a lot of his work you can hear the instruments that not only make up his usual style, but also were used for Theodore Tugboat as well. It's nice to know he sticks to what he enjoys, because that's what matters most.
You know, it would be pretty cool if Shaw returned to score another TV show, but quite honestly, just him participating in Theodore Tugboat alone has only cemented his classic style as the way it is.
Overall impression. Was it a flub or a job well done? While Theodore Tugboat is not a universal icon many people will remember, like Mickey Mouse or Thomas and Friends, the show is definitely a well-written, wholesome show that can still teach young viewers today some very important lessons. Thanks to those who made and worked on it, from Cardona to Doherty to Shaw, and everyone in between, the practical sets and music are a reminder of more simple times, and the characters still are meaningful to this day.
And that's all I gotta say. Just go out there, find those episodes, and watch them. Either that, or at least plan a trip to go see Theodore too. I know I'm going. He's a tugboat and a friendly tugboat too. A friendly tugboat too. For Theodore and Emily. For Hank and George and the harbor master too.